A very good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies today. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So our next item is our first evidence session on the House in Scotland Bill at Stage 1. The House in Scotland Bill was introduced in the Parliament by the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice on the 26th of March 2024, and the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee is the lead committee on the bill. However, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee has been designated a secondary committee and will be scrutinising Part 5 and an element of Part 6 of the bill. Part 5 makes provision about homelessness prevention, including duties of relevant bodies and assessment of housing support services and tenants affected by domestic abuse. And Part 6 makes provision about other housing matters, including mobile homes, fuel poverty and disclosure of information to the New Homes Ombudsman. The social justice issues related to fuel poverty are within the committee's remit. And before we begin today's evidence session, I first want to mention the lived experience engagement event Jeremy and I attended on Monday. This event was facilitated by Crisis, and we had the opportunity to speak with people who have experienced homelessness about what they had gone through, as well as their thoughts on the housing bill. So I'm extremely grateful to the participants for giving their time to do this, and to Crisis for helping make it happen. And the discussions we had will be very useful for the committee's consideration of the bill going forward. The clerks to the committee will prepare a note of the key points that came up during the session for the committee's website, and this note will highlight themes but will not identify anyone. However, before that, I want to take this opportunity to put some of my thoughts about the session on the record, and I'll then pass over to Jeremy so he can do the same. So we were split up into two groups, and as I said, we were facilitated by Crisis and PACT as well. And so the key themes that came out was the circumstances leading to people becoming homeless, and the processes after they were, you know, they became homeless as well, and also contact with organisations such as Shelter and Crisis and the local authorities as well. And we just kind of touched upon the support that was provided to them, or the lack of support, and the difficulties accessing that as well. It was a key challenge as well. And then touched upon as well how to prevent homelessness as well, and how organisations can work better together in order to assist people who are going through that. And then the sort of general comments on the bill as well. So I'll comment on that. And from the group that I was involved in, there was a particular theme came out about the lack of support for young people, particularly in education, and also who they engage with through that process as well. And obviously it was key that the bill made a point of ensuring that stakeholders like education know more about it, and young people are more aware and educated on the homelessness process and how they can, you know, better get help for themselves as well. So there was a concern about the lack of provision in the bill, as I said, on young people, and that came across very, very strong. There was also concern about the availability of resources to implement the Ask and Act duty properly, and any unintended consequences that come with the six-month notice period as well. One of the bigger things that came across was increased training as well from all organisations that are involved in dealing with people who have got experience of trauma. as well, and the uncertainty again about how the bill will fit together. They wanted more guidance, and they said there's potential contradictions within the bill as well. And so, for example, the aims of the domestic abuse provisions compared with the homelessness prevention provisions. So they touched upon that as well. And even one thing was the stigma with somebody who was going through welfare and benefits and not being able to get, even private landlords to take them on as well. That was really, the fact, it's like no benefit claimants here sort of thing. And even when rent increases went up, how they could afford that. So there was that uncertainty there as well. So I won't go any further. The notes from the meeting, as I said, the clerks provide and go on the website. But I'll pass over to Jeremy and see what your thoughts were on the group that you talked with, Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Can I also put on record my thanks to all those who came and spoke to us on Monday. It really was very helpful. I think the Convener has covered a lot of what I was going to say, so I won't repeat myself. I thought just two or three things. Firstly, interesting, during the pandemic, there was a much greater joined-up thinking and much greater support. So it shows that we can do it if we have the appropriate resourcing there. So I do think we need to learn some of the lessons that happened during the pandemic about working and about temporary accommodation in particular, and not lose that as we move on. I think, secondly, how organisations work together, particularly the interface between the third sector and local authorities, is really important. But often people were saying they felt that there were, it was like a kind of almost a conveyor belt. You went to one organisation and then another organisation, and you had to keep retelling your story, retelling all your information. And it would be helpful if there was a greater working between the different sectors. In regard to the bill, two things came up. Firstly, in regard to funding, as the Convener says, this will only work if the appropriate resources are put behind it. Now, that's obviously not in the bill, but it is a concern. And secondly, what happens if these duties don't happen? How will they be enforced? And who will enforce them, I think, came out. And then the final thing, which, having been a local councillor, I never thought about previously, but I thought was an interesting point, was one of the individuals really liked the temporary accommodation, was getting on well with their neighbours, but then had to move and start again in another house because that was deemed as temporary accommodation. And then the individual had to start rebuilding relationships, community, everything around her. And I do wonder if it's just a bit more flexibility between if someone is settled in a house or a flat, and that then cannot that become a permanent house and the other place become temporary. Now, there may be legal reasons behind that, which I don't understand, but that did seem to be slightly kind of, we've done it this way, this is how we always do it, rather than looking at the individual and the individual's circumstances. But very helpful, and thank you, Convener.
No, thanks very much, Jeremy. Thanks for your input there. So moving on to today's session, we will hear from two panels on the Housing Bill. I therefore welcome to the meeting our first panel. It's Maeve McGoldrick, Head of Policy and Communications in Scotland Crisis, John Mills, Co-Chair of the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers, also known as ALACHO, Head of Housing at Fife Council, and Anika Joy, Programme Director for Ending Destitution, Simon Community Scotland, and they're all joining us in the room. And we have Professor Suzanne Fitzpatrick, Director of Institute for Social Policy, Housing Equalities Research at Heriot Watt University, who is joining us remotely. So thank you all for accepting our invitation as well. Just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting about before we start. So if you could just please wait until I or the member asking the question, say your name before speaking. And for witnesses online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. And if you can indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you wish to come in on a question. And can I just remind everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So we will now move to the questions. And the first one is just a general theme. And so to what extent do you agree with the Scottish Government's overarching policy objective of the homelessness measures in the bill to create a shift away from crisis intervention to prevention activity? And can I pose that question to Anika first? Thanks.
Sure. Simon Community works with people who are homeless across Scotland, and we provide a range of support and services, particularly at the emergency and crisis end. So for people that don't have a safe place to stay on any night, hubs in city centres where people who are off sleeping and begging can access immediate support across a holistic range of services, and street teams that are out 365 days a year working with people who are off sleeping or may off sleep that night. All of those services work at the crisis end, and last year we worked with about 9,000 individuals. We're currently in June, and I already know that it's going to be significantly more than 9,000 people this year. So we really, really welcome many aspects of this bill, particularly the prevention duties, and really hope that if they're resourced and implemented well, with scrutiny and with redress duties when they cannot be met or when they're not met, we can imagine a future where our current method of operation is no longer needed to such an extent, and we will see fewer people affected by the kind of crisis sort of homelessness that we work with people. I think, unlike quite a lot of professions, we would be quite keen to see ourselves become obsolete, and this is one of the ways in which we can imagine, with the correct resource and many other measures that homelessness still require, that we could see a future where that might become more of a possibility.
Okay, thanks very much, Anika. Can I put that question to Professor Fitzpatrick?
Thank you, convener. I'm very much in favour of these, of part five of the bill. It represents a historic opportunity to establish world-leading legislation on homelessness prevention in Scotland. We already have the strongest legal safety net in the world for people who are experiencing homelessness, but to date we've failed to match that with an equally strong legal framework on prevention. And what that means is we focus almost all of our efforts on when people are already in crisis, and we funnel people into temporary accommodation, which is hugely damaging, particularly longer stays in temporary accommodation. And we know especially damaging for children. Work that Shelter and others have done has demonstrated that over the years. What this bill represents is an opportunity to move, excuse me, much closer to the optimal homelessness system, where it's the tight safety net that it was always intended to be for people whose homelessness we can't prevent, rather than the sort of default and increasingly lengthy route into social housing that it's becoming. So I very much support this. The principles behind the bill, I very much support part five. And I think it's a really critical ingredient in moving us out of the current housing crisis emergency that we find ourselves in.
Okay, thanks very much, Professor Fitzpatrick. I don't know if John or Maeve would like to come in on that.
Yeah, I'm happy to. So from crisis's perspective, it'd be no surprise we very much support these measures, homelessness prevention measures in the bill. From that experience actually stems from our members, so our people with lived experience who've come through our services, and time again, when our frontline staff are working with them, we identify that actually they didn't need to go through the homelessness system. They didn't actually need to become homeless. We could have stabilised their housing before that happened in the first place. So that's where this agenda for us has come from many years back, actually, and it's taken a long time to get here. So we're really pleased to see the legislation. And you know, homelessness is one of the most acute forms of poverty, and not only will this help to prevent homelessness, this will help to address poverty as well as a result of that. So it's, I think by introducing prevention measures, we are effectively introducing a stronger poverty programme that results in stable housing, which means that people don't end up in homelessness. And quite often people see homelessness as quite distinct and for a very small population. But when you're talking about housing instability, you're talking actually about a much larger population of people in need. So it will really address both of those agendas. And we very strongly believe one of the best ways to end homelessness is to prevent it from happening in the first place. We recognise that this bill has been introduced at a time when there is a national housing emergency that's been declared, and that needs to be acknowledged. And homelessness prevention is essential to helping tackle that agenda in terms of reducing the flow into the system. But it's not the be-all and end-all. We also do need to increase the supply of social housing. And by increasing the supply of social housing, it is one of the most effective measures to prevent homelessness. So I think to align the increased supply of social housing alongside the introduction of homelessness prevention measures is an extremely effective agenda to really stem the flow of people using a crisis response system and enabling us to transition to a system which is effectively about public service reform to be able to act early and prevent where possible.
Okay, thanks, Babe. John, I don't know if you would like to add anything to that.
Yeah, a lot's been said already, Convener. I mean, I think a lot, too, certainly the submission we made to the Parliament in terms of the bill was strong supportive of the principles. Indeed, I'm one of the original members of the PRG, so you would want me to say that and support Professor Fitzpatrick's comments. I think for us, it's about the implementation, the resourcing, the time of landing this in terms of the housing emergency. So our focus as local authorities and partners locally very much is on the crisis response, and the system's broken. It's not working as it should. So prevention has to be an important element of that, but just as Maeve said, you need to really boost social housing supply, and that's what we need to see coming forward as part of this. A lot of prevention activities are already happening across local authorities and partners. This is about boosting it and also making sure that other public bodies are legally obliged to join local authorities and others to effectively implement the provisions in the bill. So, yes, very supportive of the provisions in Part 5.
OK, that's very helpful. Thank you. And just following on from that, what benefits might a greater focus on homelessness prevention measures bring to those at risk of homelessness, you know, public bodies dealing with people who may be at risk of homeless or actually homeless? And I'll put that to John. Thanks.
Colleague mentioned education and the importance of recognising risk of homelessness in children. And the research is very, very robust about this. So a key partner for us in the local authority context is education director or education services fully being trained and become much more knowledgeable how to spot youngsters who are at risk of poverty and certainly at risk of homelessness down the line. So there's a really good example of mainstream educational working in prevention of homelessness in the West Lothian Council, which we'd like to promote to you. And certainly that was showcased at the recent Rapid Rehousing Coordinators event in Dunfermline, which I chaired. So there are a lot of good practice happening out there, but this is about consistency and raising the bar in terms of prevention. Public bodies, as defined in the bill, we could come to that perhaps, but certainly engagement has already started because they know this is coming in terms of a statute. So I think that nudge was required. I think the PRG recognised that it needed to be a legislative nudge for other public bodies to join in. So we're very pleased that that could offer potentially a route to avoid homelessness in the first place. But if homelessness does happen, an intervention much earlier, that we can then look at a wider range of housing options to help people choose where they wish to live rather than being forced to live in temporary accommodation.
Okay, that's really helpful, and it's heartening to hear as well that there is a good case study out there. I'd be keen to know more about it. I think all the members of the committee, and speaking on behalf of them, would be keen to know more about the good case study in West Lothian as well. But I don't know if anyone else would like to come in on that.
If I may, I think the benefits are sort of threefold. They're one for the individual, primarily, which is to avoid the trauma of having to go through the homelessness system, avoid the trauma of having to be stuck in a life in limbo, living in temporary accommodation, which you heard from the lived experience session. It's for to allow people more greater choice and control in their lives to be able to help stabilise the housing situation that they're in or be able to have a managed move into more secure accommodation more quickly. So, I mean, the primary benefit ultimately will be up to the individual to ensure that they don't, because becoming homeless, no one ever wants to go through that situation or believes they will. And to once you're in the system, your support needs quite often will escalate quite significantly, and you will find yourself with much more severe mental health, etc. needs. So for the individual, it's without doubt reduced trauma. For public services, it's that things can get done more efficiently and effectively further upstream. So ideally, those support needs are less and people are easier to support because they haven't snowballed over a period of 2 to 3 years. During that period of time. With this legislation, the ideal is that we have a collective partnership working, so it's not just the local authorities carrying the can on homelessness. That's a really essential, hopefully, outcome that we achieve from this legislation, that it becomes everybody's business, that all other public services work effectively together to try and help address housing needs and stabilise housing and other support needs that will have a knock-on effect on that where possible. And then the third benefit is really to the public purse, that we will need to spend initially on prevention, of course we will, because we will see an increased flow into the system overall, and that always happens when we try to tackle people earlier on. But very quickly, whenever prevention is working effectively, we know that it's much more cost effective to support somebody with low level support needs whilst they're in housing than to support somebody with high level needs whenever they're out in the homelessness system.
Okay, thanks, Maeve. I believe Professor Fitzpatrick would like to come in. Thank you.
Thank you. There's a couple of research-based points I'd like to make to support what we've just heard from my colleagues. I did some research, UK-wide research, some years ago, which looked at the routes that people take into homelessness, particularly people with more complex support needs. And what we found in that research, which did some quite detailed sequencing, is that people in that situation had come into contact with a whole range of public services well before they were anywhere near housing and homelessness services. So education has already been mentioned, but also social work services, police services, other criminal justice services, and so on. And if we want to try and prevent homelessness upstream, which is what we absolutely need to do to ease the pressure on the system and to stop those kind of harmful, detrimental consequences we've been talking about, we need to lock those other public services into the homelessness prevention framework. And the moment, as John Mills has said, we know from the research evidence from other research that we've done called Hard Edges Scotland that not enough is happening in those other public services to prevent homelessness. As Maeve said, homelessness services are very often left carrying the can, but they don't have the leverage to command the mental health resources, the substance misuse resources and so on that are needed to properly support people in that situation. They're left carrying the can because they have the clear statutory duty once someone is homeless. So what we need to do is ensure that the legal framework provides proper incentives and responsibilities for those other parts of the public sector to support local authority housing and homelessness departments, but also crucially to act within their own power, their own remit, to prevent homelessness happening in the first place.
Okay, that was really helpful, and it'd be good. I think we'll get a note of that anyway in terms of the research paper, to have a real good look at that as well. So thank you. I'm now going to move on to theme two, which is the Ask and Act duty, and I'm going to invite Bob Dorison. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for coming along this morning. So to work out how effective an Ask and Act duty may be, I think it's reasonable to work out the public bodies that are listed within the bill what they're currently doing. So not what they might do under the Ask and Act duty, but what they're actually currently doing. So I'm just wondering, maybe John Mills might be best placed, because I want to ask what they're currently doing and what their current relationship is with local authorities.
In most parts of Scotland, we have a network of public service working. It's not as integrated as it should be, and there's quite a lot of design work across local authorities with partners to look at no wrong door as an approach. So that's kind of seamless for the client or the customer at the front end coming in. So wherever someone with a housing problem, it might be homelessness, it might be overcrowding, it might be something else, touches a part of the public sector, not all public sector colleagues are asking the question, what are your housing circumstances? So that's a very important starting point. Do you have somewhere to go to if you leave A&E today? And that's not always asked. So I think the Ask and Act duty from that perspective is positive, because it says you must ask about that if you're doing an assessment of the person in front of you from whatever public body that you're actually representing. So the customer shouldn't be telling, I think Mr. Balfour said, about telling the story many times. It should only be told once. So it doesn't matter where you touch the public sector, that should be the approach. It should be a common assessment. And then obviously the receiving public body of that inquiry should try their best to find out what are the options for that person in terms of trying to get more stable housing. I think the danger comes when there's very limited service or very limited scope for that public body. Now, that has to be improved to actually do anything positive to intervene to prevent an inevitable homelessness path emerging. So the fear from us in terms of Alachua and local authorities is it just defaults to an ask and refer to the local authority, and that's what we have to avoid. So it's trying to find out the scope and design of services across the public sector that will help people at the relevant point in their journey and not actually have to claim homelessness.
And Mr. Mills, a lot of the points you raise will be asked in later questions. I'm not ignoring the very relevant points you make. I suppose what I'm trying to elicit is, in some ways, do some individuals within the public bodies listed ask and act where they can? Is this about spreading good practice in a consistent way across all public bodies and across the country, or is this a departure from what currently happens with best practice? I suppose that's what I'm trying to elicit, Mr. Mills.
There is practice where health visitors, may have community health workers, will join up with their local housing worker on a more informal basis on behalf of the customer. It's not happening consistently enough. It's not happening in depth. And that's really, I think, what the bill is trying to get to, is making it a consistent practice across all public bodies. So there is practice. It's not consistent. It's not sufficient. And that's what we need to improve.
OK, that's helpful. I was going to ask whether witnesses think the proposed statutes will help address any areas for improvement. I suspect that's almost like stating obvious. I might leave that hanging there. If properly resourced and appropriate pathways and everything else, does anyone disagree this is a significant potential to dramatically improve matters? Maybe Indica Joy, you might want to comment on that.
I think it has significant potential to improve. If, as we said earlier, the public bodies are resourced, that you know, the people that we work alongside will have touched so many different public bodies on their journey to the need for a crisis intervention, and so we want to make sure that all of those public bodies are acting to prevent before people even reach us.
Okay. Now, we a follow-up question for you, yeah. Annika Joy, and maybe I'm going to bring in a wee second to add to that. I apologise, I'm not bringing everyone. I get there's time constraints. I'm just wondering, Annika, whether or not you think the bodies listed in the bill also need to be added to. So maybe a response, any thoughts on that, and then maybe Maeve could come in to give some added comments.
So I think it shows a good measure of public bodies. And I understand why general practitioners cannot be included, because they're not public bodies. But when I spent time with colleagues and when I spent time with the people that we support, at each point you could really see how the role of a general practitioner could have played an important role. And I think it would be good for us to think together about how general practice can be supported to play its role in this, either by working alongside designated public bodies or indeed taking it, having some responsibility itself. I would also like to take this opportunity for the committee to consider whether or not public bodies that are not designated in Scotland, but such as the Home Office, could also be compelled to consider whether or not they have a duty of prevention as well, so that we don't see public bodies such as the Home Office creating serious homelessness in Scotland when they make rapid asylum decisions.
Just finally on that, Anika Joy, because this committee is taking evidence in relation to that, and a meeting I had with mayors before Christmas, who are obviously the housing agents for the Home Office, they tell me that they're not allowed to do any kind of scoping work with individuals and families who are in mayor's accommodation, who, to all intents and purposes, are likely to get a positive decision, and the first time they can talk to them about potential homelessness is at the point where they have to say, you've had a positive decision, you now have a notice to quit. That's surely got to change, Anika Joy.
I can well believe that that is the case for the contractor, but the contractor is subcontracted by a public body, yeah, by a public agency, and it's that body that I believe is failing people in its prevention, you know, in preventing the homelessness, and it's that we're picking up at the crisis point in Scotland. Local authorities and other public bodies that are listed are picking up the impact of that.
That's really helpful for the committee. Maeve McGoldrick, you've been very patient. Do you want to come and make some comments?
Certainly. To agree with everything everyone said, and I think you've asked sort of in a couple of different questions. So in summary, to a degree, there is good practice happening, but this legislation isn't about formalising that good practice. It's about a significant culture change across all public services. So building on the good practice that already is there, it's really significantly stepping up prevention activity, moving it much further upstream, and making it a collective approach to trying to stabilise people's housing, and making that collective approach a proactive approach across multiple public agencies. What we have at the moment, and we have a piece of research that we'll be publishing in the summer, but as a heads up, we had 15 case studies. Collectively, they had 80 different interactions with different public services. None of them engaged in their homelessness whatsoever. You know, we had, for example, a third of them had contact with the justice system. Half of them were in touch with social work or the education system. Two-thirds were in touch with the job centre. But housing was, and homelessness was, risk of homelessness was never addressed. When we introduced the Homelessness Reduction Act in England, I did a lot of work with the job centre because the GD does apply to job centre there, GD to refer. And even trying to apply that to, when I spoke to a regional office within job centre managers, not one of them sort of recognised their interactions with they said a very small population interacted with the homelessness system, and it wasn't really on the needs of the majority of their claimants. When I asked about housing and rent arrears and stable housing in particular, they all put their hand up. So this is about how this is framed as much as it is about the duties that we put on to people. And when you talk about people's housing needs, when you talk about their rent arrears, those other public bodies start to think, oh, well, actually, I have some control within that area. There's something within my gift I could actually do on that. But what we're finding from the research we've done so far, those interactions are happening, but there's just no recognition that actually this could be my job. I could intervene and do something effective to try and stabilise that housing. So we're not looking at the root causes of homelessness and understanding what the levers that could be pulled much earlier on. And that's really what we're trying to see in the legislation coming forward, is a much clearer articulation of what comes under Act to ensure that it's not just about listing these other public bodies and making sure that it's a name check that they're in the system. It's about actively identifying and prescribing a minimum of what they should be doing in order to help stabilise housing and support needs that it could be related to a housing outcome as a result.
Very helpful, Maeve McGoldrick. Thank you. Professor Fitzpatrick, you've also been very patient. I'm going to move on to the next question, but feel free to mop up any thoughts you have that haven't been covered yet from the previous questions. We should put on the record that some people have said in evidence that they believe we shouldn't be doing any of this at the moment, and what we should do is resource the current system adequately and make it work adequately before we move on to the next thing. A little health warning in answering that. I will come on specifically to talk about resourcing the new system in my final question with the committee, but specifically for those that say, let's not do this just now, let's make the current system work. Any thoughts on that?
Thank you. Yes, I certainly do. I think that, you know, the points about resourcing and implementation challenges have been made, and I know we'll come back to those, but and it is a challenging time at the moment. Maeve and others have already flagged that. But the key thing that I want the committee to reflect on is this is really enduring social infrastructure we're trying to put in place here. When you think about legislation, you think about the long term. The original homelessness legislation was passed in 1977. It came into force in 1978, just before the Thatcher government came to power, and it's endured for almost 50 years, and it's had its challenges on the way for sure. But I think you find very few people that would say that we should, you know, that we should abolish it. Likewise, Scotland took a very bold step in abolishing priority need gradually between 2003 and 2012. That was challenging. It meant that we brought a lot of single homeless people into the statutory system, which had been excluded, before. That was, you know, that brought all sorts of resource and other challenges. But you'd find very few people, if any, who would say we should exclude single homeless people from statutory homeless entitlements now. So I think we have to be ambitious and think in long term, through a long term perspective, when you're thinking about legislation like this. So that's kind of the sort of zooming out point. I think the more kind of focused point I would make is that, picking up on a theme that Maeve's raised, is that we really do have to do something quite radical about reducing the flow of people into the system. So it's not just this isn't an either or, that we fix the problems and the pressures that we all acknowledge are within the current system, or we do prevention. We actually have to do both, and we have to do something very significant, both in terms of protecting the system itself and the public purse, but also reducing the damage and the detriment to people that experiencing homelessness and temporary accommodation brings. So it's not a case of let's fix the current system and then let's think about prevention some further point down the line. We have to act on prevention now in order to protect the current system and to think long term, what kind of Scotland do we want to live in? I think we want to live in a Scotland where as few people as possible become homeless, and those people who do become homeless, because we can't prevent it, we offer robust support and rapid rehousing so that the use of temporary accommodation is absolutely minimal.
Thank you very much. My final, Maeve McGoldrick, yes?
Yes, just to pick up on the point that Suzanne's making, I think so. There is a point about the crisis that we're in and the system, whether it's functioning effectively or not, and the housing supply that sits behind that, which can undermine the system or can make it effective. And if, in reality, when we're talking about this legislation, this is just a legislative framework. What we need alongside this, and what we'd ask the committee to very strongly push for government to present, is a clear vision of what success looks like for homelessness prevention to be delivered. And that goes beyond a legislative framework. This is about public service reform, to transition away from a crisis system and towards an early action prevention system. In order to do that, it will take time to get this right. It is a significant transformation. If you introduce it tomorrow, it's not going to happen immediately. It will take years to embed and be truly successful. So the idea of making sure the system that we currently have is functioning, we still need to address that, and we need to get that right ASAP. But government is competent of being able to have a multi-pronged approach to tackling homelessness. We need to address the current housing emergency. We need to increase the supply of social housing, and we need to put in place a system that is designed around prevention and early action. They can all happen simultaneously. It's not a matter of wait for one to be fixed before the other begins.
Thank you. So my final question is going to be on resourcing, and I think it's reasonable to come to John Mills in relation to that, given that whilst this will spread out a statutory duty on other public bodies, we all know that at the centre, the hub of that, will be local authorities, Mr Mills. And my colleague will look at kind of pathways and referrals later, so this is more specifically about the resourcing more generally. Do you have confidence that this will be sufficiently resourced, or the financial memorandum accurately reflects the resources that will be required? I suppose I would caveat that a little bit to say that if we were going to cost everything that would have the ideal system, we'd never start it. It would just be so overwhelming. So I'm conscious that Professor Fitzpatrick spoke about the gradual implementation of what we did in relation to priority need. Do we have to be realistic and gradually implement a better system under the new statutory duties in an incremental way, given what I suppose might be a significant financial burden on a whole range of public authorities. Didn't mean to ask the question for such a length of time. Sorry, Mr. Mills, but your thoughts on that would be really helpful.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of submissions from ALACHO and indeed SOLAS, the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives, it's about the timing of implementation. I don't think anyone's against the provisions in Part 5 of the bill at all, and it's a necessary step forward. But we need to twin-track this, so you need to deal with the housing emergency. It's a broken housing system we have. That needs to be fixed. I think that will take 1 to 3 years minimum to do that. And then the starting gun for prevention needs to start relatively soon. But the implementation of the duty has to come where there's enough resources across public sector, not just in local authorities, but indeed health and social care and others. So we don't believe the current financial memorandum adequately even touches the sides of what's going to be required. And we believe there needs to be further examination of that. So for a local authority housing homelessness service point of view, we do need more housing options officers, more housing advisers, because we don't have enough to cope just now, and they're trying to tackle crisis. If you're going to develop a prevention effective work stream for people to tap into, you've got to have another cohort ready to start that and ramp it up. So that's where we are sitting at the moment with this. So nothing against the provisions in Part 5. It's more about the staged implementation of the Act and the statutory guidance clearly to come as well, which an awful lot of detail has to be worked through.
And Mr. Mills, I was wondering, would you expect a lot of that to be spelled out in the financial memorandum, because I'm conscious there'll be annual budgets from this place through to local authorities and a whole range of partner public bodies and government might say, well, that's a year-on-year basis, this is a financial memorandum to make the transition, but the annual budgets in terms of how we resource it adequately are just that, their annual budgets. Would you maybe reflect on that a little bit?
No, absolutely. I take that. I mean, the budget cycle is the budget cycle, so we accept that there has to be a case made by COSLA on behalf of local government to adequately resource this. There needs to be a case made by IGBs for similar treatment. But at the moment, what the financial memorandum says is we think it will be X million to implement. We think that's way under-resourced. Okay. And if that's the starting point, it doesn't build confidence and certainty in terms of developing, designing services. So if we're going to increase capacity in the whole public sector, there needs to be some confidence that adequate resources will come from government and indeed local authorities and health boards.
Hope other witnesses don't mind on focusing on Mr. Mills in relation to this point.
I'm conscious of the time, yes, as well, and I know you know, it's really good to get this evidence in, but we have got quite a bit to get through, so I'm just remind everybody to put their questions and answers as clear and as concise as possible. Thank you.
So it's a final question, clearly, Mr. Mills, and I suppose, and apologies to other witnesses that I've not brought you in on this point. When money does come into the system to deliver on these statutory duties, do you think it should go to each individual public body to create their own strategies, or do you think there should be a central resource at a local authority level, for example, where they co-produce what a new service may look like? Any thoughts on that, just to give the writers in relation to that, if there's time constraints?
To do that, the mechanics of how the budget works in terms of particular local authorities and, say, health and social care partnerships comes into the general fund account, and then it's obviously then contributed to health and social care. NHS Fife is one of the bodies that we're working with just now to look at capacity and training for staff. So again, there's resource already being deployed to do that. So I think in terms of our point of view, we'd like to see an overall prevention of homelessness budget or fund, like the Rapid Rehousing Transition Plan Fund, etc., that's then distributed through local authorities to other partners in the voluntary sector and other public sector bodies.
Maybe at the discretion of the convener, my business is done here asking questions. I think I've had too much air time. I think convener thinks.
Okay, thanks. If we have got time later, I'll bring you in, Maeve. But I'm really conscious of the time, and we've probably got until about 10:15. And we've still got quite a lot of themes to get through as well. So continuing on with that theme, I'm now going to invite Marie McNair in, who's joining us online. Thank you, Marie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. The Scottish Government states the intention is that referral to a local authority from relevant body should not be the default position. How can this be achieved in practice so that people don't just continue to get referred to local authorities? And what else would need to happen to ensure successful implementation of the needs duties? For example, in terms of culture change and training. I'm going to go back to Latcho, to Mr Mills. I know that you know you've touched on it earlier on in your questions, but if you could perhaps expand a wee bit, that would be really helpful.
I think it's the definition of ask and act that we're really interested in detail. I think in terms of the preparation, most local authorities and partners are already talking together. They're briefing one another. They're educating partners on the current provisions in the homelessness legislation and what may come through the bill. And initial training has already started. So that kind of resourcing is already deployed, as I said earlier. The fear that we have as local authority homelessness services is the ACT part of the Ask and Act is very limited in practice. That may improve over time as people get more confidence and competence in actually trying to deploy measures to intervene to prevent homelessness. But initially, at the point of implementation, it may actually just become an additional referral route to local authorities. And obviously local authorities would have to be resourced to cope with that. And that was what I was trying to say earlier. So I think it's about, as Professor Fitzpatrick says, when we abolished the priority need test in Scotland, there was not a lot of confidence at the start that we would cope with the workflow. And it's the same here. Now, if you're landing this on an already pressurised system, then the ability to switch resources from crisis to prevention is much more limited. So it's about building that capacity to give other public bodies the ability to do meaningful interventions that will prevent it just becoming an ask and refer. So that's a piece of detailed work we really need to do with government and with other partners to try and make sure that we have a really robust approach to housing options, housing advice. I mean, I wouldn't be averse to a GP giving some housing advice to someone, and some enlightened GPs already do that. So there's an awful lot of preparation and work to be done, but it's started. But we just need to be careful about what initially comes through the legislative duty when it's implemented at a point in time.
I know there's a lot of good practice already happening in local authorities, particularly in my own area, that I know of already. Does anybody else want to come in on that? And if not, I'll move on to my next question, just in the interest of time.
Be happy to. I think there's a couple of things that we would recommend, because there is a risk of significant referral and not enough act to happen. So what we do think the legislation can be strengthened in respect of this. So, for example, what we would like to see is greater detail under ACT, similar to what's been suggested as reasonable steps for the local authority's 6 months prevention duty. We would like to see something similar in relation to reasonable steps for those other public bodies in relation to ACT. And we think that's really important as not a glass ceiling, but a bare minimum of what should be done in order to, as I said earlier, to prescribe that what those other public bodies can do, but also, therefore, then to be able to hold them to account if they're not doing that. And that's a real concern for us, that there is a lack of accountability under the how the current Ask and Act duty is defined, how is somebody meant to have a right to review if it's not clear what's even been expected from those other public bodies. But the second really important bit, I think, is if you map out what the legislation looks like, it becomes quite linear. So the Ask and Act activity happens, then a referral to the local authority for the six-month prevention, and then if that fails, a referral into the homelessness system. What we had envisaged is a more holistic model of support between both the other public bodies and the local authority prevention teams. And what we really want to see is more of a case management, holistic model of support between Ask and Act and the 6 months prevention activities. So it's partly how this is designed and partly how the legislation is laid out, of making sure that it's not just, it's a two-way referral process. We need the housing prevention support services to be part and parcel of a wider package of holistic support from those other public bodies. And what we had recommended in the PRG report was the introduction of a personalised housing plan. which we see in the legislation in both Wales and in England on homelessness prevention. And this personalised housing plan is a really effective tool to enact quite similar to other models in the benefit system. There's a claim and commitment, for example. So it's a similar document that is owned by the individual and by both the local authority and those public bodies. And it states out really clearly what support needs have been identified for that individual, what actions will be taken by multiple bodies, and then what has been done as a consequence. And it's a document that can be come back to. And if there is an appeal that needs to be made, then there's something that is documented that can be the basis for that. So we would like to see the introduction of a personalised housing plan to bring together Ask and Act with the prevention duties and prescribe more what would be reasonable steps for under the Act duty for those different public bodies.
Thank you, and thanks for providing that further clarity. Convener, that was my next question, but it's been covered, so I'll hand back to yourself.
I believe that Professor Fitzpatrick would just like to come in. Thanks.
Thank you. I very much agree with what John Mills and Maeve have just articulated, but I just wanted to add in another point, which I've chaired a very similar panel in Wales to the PRG recently, looking to further strengthen the homelessness prevention and other aspects of the legal framework in Wales. And thinking about around this point about Ask and Act, in the Welsh deliberations, we decided that it was actually helpful to unpack that a little bit further. So the Welsh model is now, or the recommendation, which is in the current white paper in Wales to end homelessness, is duties to ask, to act, to refer and to coordinate. So it's a sort of four-part structure to separate out act from refer, particularly to pick up on the point that John Mills is making, to be very clear to the other public bodies, the relevant bodies, that act doesn't just simply mean refer. The actions within their own remits and powers are expected. They're expected then to refer where that's appropriate. But that's picking up Maeve's point about the need for it not to be seen as a sort of linear process and a more holistic process, is the referral is not the end of their responsibilities. They then have to coordinate and cooperate with the local authorities to deliver the support package that people need. So I just wonder whether that kind of Welsh thinking might be worth reflecting on as the bill proceeds through its parliamentary process.
OK, thank you very much. And I'm moving on now to theme three, which is preventing homelessness sooner by taking reasonable steps in house and support services. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning again, panel. I wonder if you could just give me some, or what are some of the problems with the legal framework which considers people to be threatened with homelessness if it's likely they will become homeless within 2 months? And what would be the benefits of extending this to 6 months or for people at risk of homelessness? I don't know who wants to go first.
If I can take that, Convener. There was a big debate in the Prevention Review Group around the timing of that, or pushing the envelope out from the 2 months to something else. Prevention of homelessness can start years in advance of a homelessness crisis. So we must not just think about it only starts at 6 months, and that's what the comments from Alacho were meant to say. And I think the 6 months was agreed as a realistic time where we could actually really ramp up prevention activity to try and prevent that crisis for that homeless household. But, you know, I think if we get an opportunity to help an offender 2 years out from release, or someone coming out of the armed forces 2 years out from demob date, that's what we should do. So the 6 months is a kind of guide to say, right, that's when the statute duty should kick in for local authority and indeed the other public bodies. But we'd like to obviously encourage much earlier intervention and prevention is really good practice.
I think we would echo that it's 6 months plus we would sort of describe it as, that we need 6 months in there because 2 months you can't prevent. 2 months you're too close to crisis, and even if you recognise that somebody is in need and about to be made homeless, you can't meaningfully intervene at that point. So the logic is to put something into legislation so there is a... And I think within the 6 months definition, we have recommended that we need to define more clearly in legislation what that could mean within 6 months, so there is, so people don't get turned away whenever they go to their council for help. But it very much is a minimum, and you know, we've talked to local authorities who are talking about using data to predict cohorts likely to become homeless and in more effective ways to really reach people upstream. So it should be no means by a glass ceiling, but it needs to be in legislation to have consistency of approach, and we need to clearly define what 6 months means.
We would also support the 6 months, but the holistic approach to embedding homelessness prevention in every aspect of society, much as we're trying to embed a trauma-informed response and a poverty prevention response in every aspect of society. It can start at zero and continue through someone's lifetime, rather than it being... This is about an intervention that will reduce the amount of trauma impact, but a much earlier holistic approach across the whole of society will be much more likely to have impact.
Professor, I don't know if you want to jump in or not.
Just very, very briefly, I mean, again, very much agree with what my colleagues have said, but I think one of the sort of consistent themes that's come through research in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK on this is that local authorities under pressure have historically said to people who have tried to approach them, you know, earlier than the 2 months or the 1 month as it was until the legislation changed, you know, basically go away and come back when you're closer to crisis. And I think one of the key things which this change in the legislation should help to obviate is that sort of go away and come back when you're closer to crisis. I mean, the role that legislation and statutory frameworks play in shaping incentives, in leading culture change, in raising expectations and raising the bar, as my colleagues have said, is critically important. And I think the six months plus, as John Mills, Maeve McGoldrick and Annika have said, but I think it's also just about sending out that signal that we shouldn't be waiting to the crisis point in order to intervene.
If I could just pick that point up, because obviously the legislation says 6 months, it doesn't say 6 months plus. And obviously we're looking at a bill and we're looking at what would then become law. So are you then looking for, I expect in your submission maybe you said you'd want how it's defined, set out probably in regulations a bit more detail, but do you want that 6 months plus better defined within the Act as it is at the moment?
What we'd recommend it is to be in legislation. I think the plus bit might get quite complicated to put into legislation,
yeah,
and that probably comes into guidance. But in terms of the bare minimum of 6 months to ensure that we have that basic best practice, we would recommend that, and that needs to be in legislation.
I suppose what we don't want to do is end up with local authorities turning you away because you're 8 months away rather than... And I appreciate what John said, we want to do it as soon as we can, but when you've got limited resources within a legal structure, that could become the default position, which is the danger, I suppose.
Yeah.
If I can go on, and I'll start with crisis, since it was in...
Oh, sorry. Before you move on to the next question, yeah, I believe Ros would
like
to come in. It's okay. Would like to come in with a supplementary.
My apologies, and I will be very brief. And it's off the back of what Professor Fitzpatrick just kind of said there. And it's, I know it's slightly off-piste, but it's regarding first-tier tribunals. I have a few cases that have come forward where I believe that councils are actually requesting that tenants move into that process and are really moving that forward. Is this a breakdown in the system that that you're currently highlighting, that we're actually so stretched at the moment that we're having to move into a different process, and we're currently asking residents to actually go through a tribunal process rather than address the issue at hand? I don't know if Professor Fitzpatrick wants to come back on that, and maybe if Mr. Mills could come back just with a quick answer.
I don't think I have a response to that particular question. Sorry, Rose, I'm not familiar with what's going on in that context.
Then maybe it's Council.
In the context of housing crisis or a housing emergency, we want to make sure that if people are in accommodation and they have legal rights, that they exercise them to the full degree of the law. Now, I think what we'd like to move to, and that's about fixing the system, is a system where we have adequate temporary accommodation, because we don't have at the moment. We don't have enough permanent housing options that people can move on to in housing associations or councils. So good practice in an allocations policy for housing is to try and pick someone off the list before they move into a much more difficult situation. That's pretty well come to an end in Scotland. So it's about reversing that kind of pressure we have at the moment and getting out of the housing emergency. And then we won't be in a position where people have to stay where they are despite they don't want to, but they're actually adequately housed in most cases, and we're actually asking them to exercise their legal rights to prevent their homelessness as long as possible so that we have time to prepare a housing option for them. So that's in essence what I think most local authorities are doing just now.
OK, thank you, Convener. Thank you for the time.
I'll let Jeremy back in. Thank you.
I think to some extent you've picked this up already, but you might just want to expand on it slightly. In your submission you said more clarity will be needed to ensure people can access support when a problem is identified and are not turned away and told to come back when the crisis is imminent. I think that's a quote from your submission. I think you said a bit about that, but do you want to just unpack that slightly more so we can have an understanding of what we should be looking at?
Certainly. So in the PRG report, we give examples of this. For example, the notice to quit. People, formal notice like a notice of possession, but it can be more formal, informal things like a loss of employment, rent arrears building up. So it's having some forms of definition of what it means, examples of what people can take to their local authority to sort of illustrate that they are 6 months away from experiencing homelessness. So as I say, whether that some of those will need to, we suggest, should sit in the legislation, and others will sit in guidance, the less formal things like loss of employment or falling into rent arrears. And also I think this is where the system can't be a linear process, that we need to join up with those other public bodies that might be able to flag a debt advice agency, social services, etc., the RSLs identifying that people are falling into rent arrears, that we need to be able to work with the local authority prevention team, and they can help justify the fact that somebody has unstable housing and this is the type of support they need from the local authority, whilst the other public bodies can provide wider support services.
Thank you, Gimino.
Can I just remind everybody again that we're really short on time at the moment, and to keep questions and answers as succinct and concise as possible, please. Can I going to introduce John Mason, and thank you.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, maybe to build on what Mr Balfour was saying, I think, Mr Mills, in your submission, you talked about when a household themselves feel or understand themselves to be at risk of homelessness. Now, that would I mean, some people obviously are worriers and do come to me, and others worried about homelessness. Other people are the opposite, though. They may realise they've got debt problems, and they actually don't really believe they're going to be made homeless until the very last minute. Is that a problem?
Everyone's different, and I think we've got to make sure. I mean, my colleague talked about personal housing plan. A lot of that is already implemented. It's probably one dimensional at the moment in terms of housing rather than broader. But, you know, different people approach local authorities for advice, not claim homelessness, but they're just looking for general housing advice. It becomes apparent to the housing advisor they are in significant risk of homelessness. What can we do to help? Others will put it off to the last thing. They'll not open letters. They'll not respond to inquiries about rent arrears or whatever until it absolutely is in their face. So everyone's different. I think what we've got to do as part of this overall design of a really robust prevention system is to get much more information out there, mm-hmm. much more early help through a variety of agencies, not just a local authority, so that people don't have to think they have to wait until the 11th hour before they seek help. So the 6 months out from the homelessness crisis is a period that we can do a lot more information and speaking to people and giving them housing advice and money advice, etc., mm-hmm. so that we can try and intervene. But at least people are much more aware of what their rights are, yes. and how they can access housing and what are the range of housing options that they can access. And at the moment, it's too narrow. Yes. We need to broaden that out as part of this prevention approach.
And to be a little bit cynical, I mean, if we give a family, say, you know, they get a lot of advice on debt and things, and they've actually managed to keep their home, does that not just mean another family is going to be sitting longer on the waiting list?
I think inevitably at the moment, as we respond to the homelessness housing emergency, you're sitting on waiting lists, or housing lists, as I like to call them, much longer than we would like. And that then, you know, increases insecurity, because people are living in insecure accommodation with friends, relatives, etc. And I think the dynamic that's changed since the pandemic is people are not able to make their own arrangements as readily as they used to before the pandemic. People, when they come to the local authority as a potential homeless household, they inevitably need temporary accommodation, where in the past they could have made their own arrangements. Mm-hmm. I think overall there's a shortage of housing options, and certainly social rented housing options. So people, we're still in the domain where people have to come to the council to, as a last resort, to seek housing, where it should be a first choice rather than that. So, you know, unless we get that equation resolved in terms of the shortage of housing supply, people are going to spend longer on housing lists. But our duty at the moment is to make sure that we try, mm-hmm. 2 months out, try and prevent as much as we can of homelessness. But inevitably, 90-odd% of our activity is crisis intervention.
Yes. I mean, Ms. McGoldrick, yep. Are we just moving people around in the system rather than we're still going to have the same number of people homeless, but so, just be different ones?
So on that point, I think it's supply and demand really is what you're trying to get at. And what I said at the very start, that you need a three-pronged approach. Go above and beyond like we did in the pandemic with something different for the, dealing with the backlog, the housing emergency. Build enough homes to meet demand and introduce prevention measures. So yes, for this to be successful, we need enough housing options for people to be able to move into.
And sorry, but if we don't have the money, then we can't build more houses, can we?
Pardon?
If we don't have the money, we can't build more houses.
No, and we also need to look at other houses. So social housing isn't the only option for housing outcomes. We do need to make more use of the private rented sector. One of the things that we would suggest that could sit under the prevention activity within the local authority is to have ensuring that what we call help to rent schemes, PRS access schemes, are available across all local authority areas to help incentivise landlords to want to let people on low-income tenants. And this works really well. We've provided the help to rent schemes, and it opens up the private rented sector market to people who are at risk of homelessness with low incomes, and it helps stabilise that tenancy for both the tenant and the landlord, ensure that people don't fall into rent arrears, they understand how to pay their bills, etc. So thinking a bit creatively about other housing options, but do not lose sight of the target that we need for social housing, because if that goes in the wrong direction, prevention will not be successful.
OK, thanks. I mean, I realise we are short of time. And
I'm going to intervene here right now because I am really conscious of time, and a lot of other members are still wanting to come in and different themes from the bill. So I'm sorry about that, John.
I mean, Mr Durr's got 20 minutes.
Yeah, I know. I asked them to be as clear and concise as possible. And what I'm suggesting is any further questions that you've got for any of the panel members, be happy to write to them and ask for a written submission back as well. So I'm sorry about that. Apologies, John. So moving on to the theme on domestic abuse, I'm going to invite Katie Clark in. Thank you.
And the policy aim of the legislation in relation to domestic abuse is to help protect the rights of women and children experiencing domestic abuse and financial control living in social housing to remain in their own home or be rehoused if that is their wish, and to ensure arrears accrued because of domestic abuse are not a barrier to accessing social housing in the future. So to what extent do you think the bill's provision relating to domestic abuse achieve this stated policy aim? I don't know if there's a particular witness that would want to come in.
Quickly, we welcome the proposals in this area. Women experiencing domestic abuse is one of the lead causes to women experiencing homelessness. So all we can say on this is we do welcome the proposals that are in the bill.
I hear that we also welcome the proposals.
Yeah, and from a local authority perspective, we absolutely support the provisions in the bill. And indeed, in terms of requiring social landlords to have a dedicated domestic abuse policy, that's overdue, and we'd like that to be implemented as soon as possible.
Okay. And maybe Professor Fitzpatrick, is there any concern at all in relation to these provisions, that they need to be strengthened or they're not quite right? Or do you, it seems to be quite positive feedback.
Yes, I, like my colleagues, I'm very much in favour of these recommendations, which are completely in line with the recommendations of the PRG group, so no concerns.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to theme five, which is equalities issues and impact on rural areas. I'm going to invite Ros McCollin. Thank you,
Convener. What are the equalities issues arising from the issues in the bill? Does the bill sufficiently account for impacts on different equality groups, or is there other actions needed to make improvements? Anika, could I have yours, please?
So homelessness affects different equalities groups differently. Some groups are more likely to find themselves homeless. So people who are racialised in Scotland are more likely to find themselves homeless. They're also less likely to have had positive interactions with other public bodies who would have perhaps intervened or acted and asked and acted earlier as well. So I think it's really important that in the implementation of the measures in the bill, we consider the discrimination and the potential for exclusion for people who are, for example, racialised, for women, for people from LGBTQ plus communities as well, that their interactions with the public bodies will also be at risk of not being at the most positive.
Okay, thank you. And anyone else, briefly?
Just very quickly. Yeah. A full equalities impact assessment would be really positive. In terms of gypsy travellers, we as SALACHO support that, and we're trying to, at the moment, through local authority action, move gypsy travellers' sites from the general fund account onto the housing revenue account. And there is a need to really push that forward so that gypsy traveller tenants are treated the same as social rented tenants. So that's very welcome, and that certainly is something that we are keen to collaborate on. One or two other issues. In terms of fuel poverty, we believe that the bill is a general tidy-up of existing legislation, so that's very welcome. I don't think we had a lot to say in our response to that, just generally welcome the measures.
Thank you. So are there any differences between homelessness and solutions to tackle this in rural areas of Scotland? And if so, how far do the provisions in the bill seek to address any specific issues in rural areas? I think I need to come back to yourself, John, maybe on that one, from a council perspective across the board.
When we look at rapid rehousing transition plans across Scotland, there are particular difficulties in rural areas in terms of building housing, costs and availability of workforce and contractors. So that's an issue that needs to be tackled through housing supply. But particularly good progress being made in rural parts of Scotland, Aberdeenshire and others, with trying to reduce the reliance on temporary accommodation. They haven't been faced with the same level of homelessness application increase as the big city and urban authorities in the central belt. So there is a geographical difference at the moment in terms of that housing emergency. And you can see that in the number of authorities who have so far declared housing emergency. So yes, we've got to be very particular and specific about what we do to support housing options in rural areas. And I think the government has already proposed that through various work streams through the housing supply programme.
And the provisions in the bill, are adequate?
You could always go further.
I think they're
welcome. There is a recognition there. But certainly, maybe through further discussion, through statutory guidance and the housing supply programme, I think those measures could be improved.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Moving on to theme six, which is the implementation and other issues, I'm going to invite Paul O'Kanan, who's joining us remotely. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I was just keen to understand the view on how clear the bill is about the new homelessness duties and their enforcement. So essentially, who is going to be responsible for monitoring relevant bodies' compliance with the duties? Because I think that's crucial.
With that, if that's okay. So I think in terms of the big picture stuff, what we mentioned earlier, sort of reiterate that we would really like to see Scottish Government set out a clear vision of what success looks like. What is that? How do we know when we get there? What does it look like, and what is good for everyone involved? In relation to that,
the bits that are missing in when we set out our own vision of this are the outcomes, the defined outcomes for each of the public bodies, and how do we therefore then record that? How do we know when a public body believes it's achieved an outcome, for example? Where does that information get sent, and what does that mean in terms of does the system stop, or do people still need other types of support, etc.? Because you will have multiple strands of activity, and some support may stop, but other support may need to carry on with a different public body. So it's not a matter of one element gets addressed and everything, and people come out of the system. It's a holistic service, so it's quite complex, and therefore we need that vision of what the reform of this looks like, and how to identify those outcomes, where they get measured, and ultimately what accountability is in the system. And as I said earlier, there is a right to review under the local authority prevention activity, but there is no right to review under the ask and act duties for those other public bodies. So there is an absence of there that we need to address within the legislation.
If I can maybe come in. Certainly the role of the Scottish Housing Regulator, I would assume, would look at statutory duties in the round. They look at meeting statutory duties in the current homeless legislation for local authorities, and they would be the body that would obviously look at the prevention of homelessness duties. The courts clearly test cases in courts to test the compliance with statutory duty or not. It's already happening in the homeless legislation. We would anticipate it happening in the prevention duties. The Homeless Prevention Strategy Group, which is responsible for monitoring and implementing the Ending Homeless Together plan for Scotland, set up a number of task and finish groups over the last couple of years. So a task and finish group on monitoring and measuring outcomes in the Ending Homeless Together plan, which includes prevention of homelessness, has reported into the government, and we're waiting on that response. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Paul, you...
Yeah, sorry, Jamila, thanks. I think in the interest of time, I think we can obviously maybe follow up on those points.
Okay, that's lovely. Thanks very much. And the very last question, I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour back in. Thank you.
Almost the biggest question of them all. But anyway, are there anything else in the bill that could include to improve homelessness prevention services and support for victims of domestic abuse? So if you had a chance to rewrite any of this, what would you put in?
In relation to domestic abuse specifically? Or
and any other matters at all?
Oh, big blue sky thinking. I think the main thing is money, to come back to with this, really. Sort of, we do need to cost up what the activities entail. That's sort of, it's not part of the legislation designed, but it's essential to the effective delivery. That the bit that, in order to get the funding right, we need to clarify what ACT means and be able to cost it accordingly. So I would say that's sort of the biggest area. If you really want to shift prevention further upstream, we need to be a bit more, add more substance to what ACT means in practice. And we need to make sure that we have the design and infrastructure to allow for a holistic support model. So when it comes to implementation, we would recommend what has been alluded to previously, of there is a period of test and learn before the legislation is coming in. This may come in 2027, 2028, but we can start now to pilot and test out what is needed. So alongside the legal framework we and the costings for delivery of this, we need to look at a national communication strategy around the importance of home and a stable home, and the fact that you can go to a range of public bodies, and not just those listed within the legislation, thinking about using the third sector. The other public bodies, such as the Job Centre, play such a critical role in this, the Home Office, etc., that we need to bring into that ecosystem. So we need to look and work with those other public bodies. Crisis has already started to work with job centres in Scotland to make them aware of this legislation and identify what they could do to identify housing needs within their benefits claim assessment, for example. So there's a lot that can be done before the legislation actually comes in to prepare for this. We need to ensure that, as well as the communication strategy in place, that we actually have the IT infrastructure. And one point that hasn't been mentioned, and I should have said at the start, that is essential to holistic integrated services working effectively, is data sharing protocols being in place. So that may be something that's absent from the existing legislation, or it might want to sit elsewhere. We need to look to see if the data sharing protocols do allow for a really effective holistic service across a range of public bodies. And then the last thing I would suggest in that conscious of time is just, it's the point that we made in our submission, is really ramping up the role of health and social care in particular in relation to this. And this can either come through the prescribing under Act, the Act duty, what this means in practice, or we can build it into the planning model. And we welcome the housing needs assessment within the legislation, but what we would like to see is integration with the health and social care boards in particular and the community planning boards to come together to provide that holistic planning to lead to holistic service.
Can I come in very quickly?
Very quickly, we are really over time.
The best way to prevent homelessness is to build more social rented homes, so there's got to be a strengthening of the link between prevention through the bill and also the need to meet targets nationally and find the means, because it's difficult to actually finance building many more social rented homes. Over 80% of the people that approach local authorities for help just simply need a roof over their head.
Okay, thanks very much. So that concludes our evidence session. So can I just say thank you to all of you for your contributions today. I'm conscious that we weren't able to bring everyone in, and there is several questions that maybe some of the members would like, and we'll write to you and seek a response back from you as well. So thank you again, and I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the set-up of our next panel.
Hi, Meg, it's Peter from Broadcasting. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can.
Very welcome back, and I now welcome our second panel on the Housing Bill. Jules Oldham, Head of Policy, Scottish Women's Aid, and Gordon McRae, Assistant Director, Communications and Advocacy, Shelter Scotland. And they are both in the room with us today. And we have Maggie Burungis, Chief Executive of Homeless Network Scotland, who is attending remotely. So thank you all for joining us today. We will move straight away to questions, and I am very conscious of time this morning, so can I just remind everyone to be as succinct and concise as possible when posing your questions and answering them as well. So the first theme is based on the general one, and I'm going to ask Gordon, first of all, to what extent do you agree with the Scottish Government's overarching policy objective of the homelessness measures in the bill to create a shift away from crisis intervention to prevention activity? Thank you.
Thank you. In terms of the outcome that's being sought, we absolutely share that desire. We want to see a homelessness system that focuses on prevention, that supports good prevention work. Our, I would say, pessimism, I hope not cynicism, is that such as the starting point we find ourselves at just now, where we have 10 local authorities either in or at heightened risk of systemic failure in our homelessness systems, which is an extraordinary intervention by the housing regulator in our view, and one which has not really been addressed so far. Where we have 8 local authorities that have declared a housing emergency, effectively saying they do not have the capacity to meet the scale of demand. And when we look at the homelessness statistics and we see existing duties are being breached on an industrial level every single day of the week, it just raises a question as to whether or not imposing new duties with a financial memorandum that is incomplete, I think government would acknowledge it's incomplete, there's no projection in terms of education, there's no projection in terms of anything other than local government services, it just raises our concerns as to whether we're trying to do more of the same with the assumption that if we impose duties on public bodies, it will directly lead to an improved outcome. So we find ourselves in a difficult position. We agree with the objective. We're just uncertain as to whether this bill in this form and with this lack of detail can ensure the outcomes that we're seeking.
OK, I'm just wondering if Maggie or Jules would like to come in on that. Jules?
So certainly in terms of domestic abuse, you've got 1 in 4 women are likely to experience domestic abuse in the UK. And recent Scottish Police Scotland stats show 62,000 incidents reported to them across a year, which we think is smaller than the bigger picture. So if we think of those and compare that to the homeless presentations, we have real concern that just now, why are all these women not actually making that move to their local authority to present as experiencing homelessness? And we're very aware from many conversations across the country that this is down to provision. So we have women who would prefer to stay within a home within such risk where it's not too extreme to say a woman could be murdered within that home. They would prefer to be there than to go to a local authority to end up within a bed and breakfast or temporary accommodation. That's a dire situation. So for us, it's really that provision and understanding it's not just down to the accommodation itself, but that whole approach and the advice and the understanding that's kind of part and parcel of that, that's not there just now. And that's a real concern to us that until we're at that point, we're very much appreciative of that, so much within the bill, but until that's really addressed and really resourced well, we don't really feel like the bill's going to achieve what we all would like it to do.
OK. And Maggie, I don't know if you would like to come in. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And yes, of course, these recommendations for prevention duties that are now written through the Homeless Bill were made back in 2018, which is 6 years ago. And as we all know, in that period, homelessness has increased. So we are absolutely in favour of taking a preventative approach and critically creating this legal structure to enable that to happen. And I think our sense is that some of the concerns that are really legitimate are in implementation, and that it's incumbent on all of us to come together and figure out how best this opportunity that's created by a legal framework to prevent homelessness can best be implemented. So if we're thinking about homelessness increasing over the last 6 years, I mean, what's driving that increase is broadly in two parts. It's firstly, as was mentioned in the earlier panel, but absolutely worth asserting again, it's firstly about the big structural drivers, about poverty, inequality, about housing supply, about the benefit system and the labour market. But it's secondly and critically also about the systemic drivers of homelessness. Now, to us, that's about how adequately the systems react, the housing system, how health and social care services react to homelessness and to people's health and well-being, and how quickly and adequately the homelessness system can react to prevent homelessness. So homelessness in Scotland is increasing because of failures on both those points, but it's on the second point, on those systemic drivers, that what the prevention duties do is provide a real laser focus on. And that, to me, is the opportunity that's presented in the bill and in the prevention duties that we can't afford to miss. So we'll achieve a legal framework to make homelessness the responsibility of sectors who just interact with people who are at risk of homelessness earlier, much closer to home. And to be absolutely honest, that's people that the homelessness sector just doesn't have a line of vision on. It's too late for us that work in the homelessness sector to help people earlier on, which is why we need this broader list of organisations and public bodies to get involved and to share that responsibility. And just finally, and very quickly, Homeless Network Scotland was a member of the Prevention Review Group that, of course, made the recommendations that led to the development of the provisions within the bill. But probably more importantly, we supported a group of people with lived experience of homelessness who worked in parallel to the work of the Prevention Review Group. They were part of the change team and they made up a group called the Prevention Commission, and they were excellent and they worked incredibly hard throughout the whole process. Okay. Now, one of the things the Commission commented on, and very quickly, sorry, was the many missed opportunities to help people earlier. And when we asked them how we might do that, they said, just ask people.
Okay, thanks very much. That's really helpful. I'm moving on to theme two, which is the ask and act duty. I'm going to invite Bob Doris in. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everyone. Now, I'm just going to roll the questions together here, but there's various parts to it, so I'll leave it to witnesses how they wish to address the questions. So it's back onto the ask and act duty again. What is your view of how the relevant bodies listed in the bill currently work to prevent homelessness as matters stand just now? And how good are links with local homelessness services in your view? And do you think the proposed statutory ask and act duty will help address any areas for improvements? There's lots in that, convener, but I'll leave it to witnesses how they want to respond. Maybe Jules Oldman.
On the face of it, you hear it and think, of course, it's a no-brainer having everybody involved. And then you, from our perspective, you look and consider domestic abuse. Why does she not just leave? You know, that's something that comes up time and time. Why does she not leave? Well, because the point where a woman actually does leave, that's where the risk is the highest. That's the risk, that's where real risk is. And, you know, again, touching on my last comment, as high as a woman being murdered. So the femicide census recently showed that within the first month of leaving, 38% of women who were killed as a result of domestic abuse, so they were killed in the first month, and 89% within the first year. That demonstrates this first year of leaving, it's really critical to get that right. To put that burden on the shoulders of numerous people in all different roles across the country and think that a day's training here and there or a bit of support here and there is going to be enough to actually ensure that a trauma-informed approach with a real understanding of domestic abuse as well as housing, as well as homelessness, when it's not your core job, you know, when that's actually not what you're doing on a day-to-day basis, that you're going to be able to do that without causing harm or risk. It doesn't feel that kind of possible. So, however, we do see that there's potential. So we're suggesting that instead of that, we look at the where there's buildings, kind of a very basic way of thinking it, where there's a building. So where there's a prison, where there's a hospital, where there's a hospital in terms of mental health, where there's a police cell. Where there's one of those provisions, we attach Ask and Act to that. So then there can be one expert, depending on the size, or a group of experts. We can have third sector pulled in. Real expertise that allows that Ask and Act ethos and real kind of real providing that different approach to, you know, it's a fabulous idea, but it allows that to be done with absolute expertise connected to specific areas. It takes the SURE standards, so, you know, which we've done pretty well on that, sustainable housing on release for everyone, but we only got so far with it. It takes something like that and really builds on that. Sirenians just now, they've got their hospital in reach outreach service. I think that also shows something like that is a great thing to build, ask and act on. So if we look at those, build upon those, and that means in terms of domestic abuse and homelessness across the board, those people who are taking that on and taking that on their shoulders as their responsibility and work day in, day out, they can really help people and provide that advice and provide that support without that risk either way. So we don't think it's a no-go overall, but as it stands just now, the risk is far outweighs what would be seen as kind of positives.
Very helpful. Gordon McRae.
Sure. In terms of the list of bodies, I think the obviously glaring omission is general practitioners. I appreciate they're not public bodies in that sense, and it's a difficult area to connect with. But in the kind of the bigger point around how is it implemented, how can we make sure, and I reiterate, we want to see prevention services work. Our concern is that the way, you know, whilst the legislation talks about it not being a default setting to make a referral to local authorities, where we have seen, and you know, Jules just reflected one, we ran a prevention service in hospitals in Fife, it required putting housing experts in those services. So the question is, where is the spare capacity in these services to divert it into these new ways? And if there's not spare capacity, where is the additional resourcing coming from? So for us, this is that, you know, we have seen a significant implementation gap in other areas of public policy. Our concern is not philosophical about the proposals, it's more about how it can be implemented in reality.
I'm sure a colleague will come on to resourcing in short order. I don't know if Maggie wants to come before we move on to my next line of questioning.
Yes, please. Thank you. And actually, yes, overall, we agree that, you know, the legal framework is broadly correct. There are some tweaks and improvements that the earlier panel noted, and I'll go into ourselves here, there's no doubt. But particularly the reasonable steps, providing a new framework to actually underpin that range of prevention activity that already happens. So some of what's good in the current system around about prevention, what this framework can do is underpin that and expand upon it. But there is absolutely loads to get right in delivery, and the collaboration will be key. And actually, just in the interest of wholeness, that the financial memorandum just doesn't go far enough, and it doesn't properly assess the financial costs to those other public bodies that are listed. Again, just to reassert a point that's made earlier, that it would be ideal to see GPs listed within those lists of other groups. Of course, they're not public bodies, but so much rests upon that, and there's so much evidence that instructs us about spikes in use of health services and GP services ahead of homelessness. So if there's more that can be done within a legal framework or within the delivery that can capture that point, that would feel key.
OK, Okay, and only because it came up in the first session, does any witness disagree with the Home Office be considered to... No, we can't put a statute in the Home Office, but do they also have a role to play?
If it's within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament to do that, then absolutely. Would we like to see it? Of course. I mean, we certainly have seen the release process being devastating to the provision of homelessness okay. services.
I better move on before the convener chastises me for going off on tangents with my scrutiny. So I've got another question for Jules. I think you may have answered this in part, but it's such an important area. I think I'll just say the question again. If there's anything you want to add, please do. Can you say more about how Ask and Act, that approach might impact on those at risk of domestic abuse? I think you were alluding to some of that earlier in relation to dangers and not being trained properly and everything else. What needs to happen to ensure that women are not placed at further risk? And if you want to say any more about your alternative proposals, which again I think you were hinting at in your earlier answer.
Sure. So, I mean, really, it would require a trauma-informed approach, of course, but it would require a domestic abuse and trauma-informed approach. So for that to take place, again, back to resources, that it feels, will that take place and then will that continue? What we don't want is there to be that a rollout. People attend a 1, 2, or 3 day training course and that's it. You know, something being a trauma-informed service is quite a different service to how things were maybe 10, 15 years ago. And we do suggest that in our approach, actually, is that that's maybe something else that could be added to this. So we have the buildings that I've said, if we attach Ask and Act purely to where there is a building. But also, we could be taking that a step further and saying, but overall, everywhere having a more trauma-informed and domestic abuse approach will help, but shouldn't be attached to the Act duty. Kind of part of that. And what I've maybe not touched on is where the Equally Safe framework also provides a possibility within this. It's quite strange to have a framework that really has such robust thinking in terms of what we do and how our practices with violence against women and girls in Scotland, and yet that doesn't seem to align with this bill or how we're working in Scotland. And that feels like a real opportunity to see how those two areas can kind of work together. But overall, our suggestion is, yeah, that it's where there is Ask and Act is connected to a hospital, to a mental health hospital, to a prison cell, to a police cell, to enable that really to be connected to experts and not this en masse expectation that everybody is going to be resourced well enough, not just day one, but day 865 down the line to actually be able to kind of act upon appropriately and with the right understanding and what's happening in the community and what are your referrals and what's, you know, there's a lot of undermines the expertise of anybody who's expert in their field on something, you know.
I think that's very helpful evidence. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John. Thank you.
Thanks very much, convener. And perhaps building on that and looking at the financial memorandum, is it the feeling of members of the panel that there's enough money or not enough money there for all of this extra duty that people are taking on? Mr. McCree?
I don't think the financial memorandum is credible in terms of the scale of change that this bill implies.
Right. Would you like to see double money or three times?
Doesn't include any assessment of education, of wider health sector. So, as I understand it just now, it is primarily a view of homelessness services in local government in terms of the memorandum as it applies to local authorities. So it hasn't expanded. The request that was made at the time of producing it didn't go beyond that initial point of contact. So for you as legislators to take a view as to what is the potential financial burden that will come from this, I don't think you've been provided with that information so far.
Right. I mean, I think the government centrally is going to provide guidance and training and things, it says.
Well, I'll look forward to that.
Say again?
Look forward to that.
You look forward to that, right. Right. I mean, well, I'll move to Ms. Oldham. Do you have an idea of a figure you would like to see, or do you think there's enough resources, or what do we need to put?
Yeah, I mean, we're not economists, but it certainly felt like it doesn't feel like it is a sector-wide response, that this has all felt like it's been about partnerships, working together, possibilities of all the public bodies coming together, and that doesn't feel like that's reflected in the figures that are down there. So,
okay, Ms. Bringes, would you like to be more specific and give us a figure of what should be there?
I think what I can definitely do is support what Gordon and Jules both said. There's a broad consensus that the financial memorandum doesn't go far enough. It was taken through the limited lens of homelessness services, incredibly important starting point. But if what we need the prevention duties is to go broader, then the financial assessment, it has to go as broad as that. I mean, it's absolutely it's no doubt that you spend to save in prevention, but you do save, but you do need to front load that, and the financial memorandum just doesn't address the need for us to do that.
I mean, would it be fair to say that there's a kind of mixture, because for some people it is going to mean you have to spend an extra 15-20 minutes with somebody else it might be even longer, some people it's just a few seconds asking them have they got a house okay. So would you agree it would vary quite a lot?
I think that what the prevention duties are largely is a people required capacity. It's absolutely about the need for people to spend more time, ask more questions, have a targeted focus, and be trained and be released from their day job, and to be trained and supported and capacity build, the time to build those collaborations with other sectors, so that different services and sectors can wrap around the person and prevent their homelessness and their housing being lost. That takes time, and it's that time that needs invested in.
And that would apply to GPs as well, and we've already heard mention that it would be good to have GPs in there. So do you think, I mean, presumably we could pay GPs and they would do it, or employ a link worker or something like that?
I absolutely agree. And that would be key and fundamental to the success.
OK, thank you. The government says the intention is not to have everybody referring to local authorities. The question is, can that be achieved in practice? What else do we need to ensure successful implementation of the duties, do you think? Can I start, Ms Oldham?
Well, I don't think it should align with local authorities, we've already, GPs have been mentioned, but I think health at large has definitely a part to play, and I don't see that within the Ask and Act, actually, element of this. I think within homelessness prevention at large, just a better understanding in terms of homelessness and where... And seeing homelessness as actually part of someone's health and well-being. I think were every sector to consider the importance of a home at the core of what they were actually working towards, that would go a long way to us getting somewhere better in terms of everything, instead of everything sitting on the shoulders of local authorities just now. Andrew Waugh did a fabulous bit of research that I think the whole sector continues to quote 7 years down the line in terms of how health and homelessness were so intrinsically kind of interlinked. And until we really recognise that home needs to be a part of every political sphere and agenda, then we're failing that, and people will continue to only go through the local authorities and only go through the local authorities at the last minute. And yeah, we're failing overall on there.
Mr McRae, can we get other bodies really involved?
We can if we invest in good training and good service provision. And there are good examples. If you look at the justice system with the SHORE standards that Jules mentioned earlier on, there is a good a bit of case study there of what can be done with a prolonged commitment at leadership level and in services. I would, however, point out that things like the new early release kind of slightly wash that all away. So we go back to, if this is a legal framework, how robust is it in the face of the sorts of changes and exceptions that have become the norm in recent years? And that's where we just get worried. We're already in a position where those duties that public bodies already have to do are not being implemented, and there is no consequence to them not being implemented. How can we ensure that this additional set of responsibilities can be enforced and can be enforced from the individual but also from a regulatory perspective. And our concern is that if this is implemented badly, it will just be a new referral pathway to homelessness services, because there isn't that spare capacity in these public bodies to pick up the responsibilities unless there's clarity around what new resource and what new, I don't mean sanctions in a financial sense, but what accountability will be built in to those public bodies to show that they're delivered on their responsibilities.
Okay, well, I think that's helpful. Can I ask the government for its response? Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. Now moving on to theme three, which is preventing homelessness sooner. I'm going to invite Ros McCollin. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. What are some of the problems with the current legal framework which considers people to be threatened with homelessness if it's likely they will become homeless within 2 months? And will extending the definition to 6 months actually make any difference? Is there any benefits to it? Mr McRae first, then. Thank you.
Yes, I mean, we very much support the extension. I'm quite sympathetic to the lateral view of kind of 6 months plus. I think we recognise that service providers have to exist within a set of thresholds and limits. But as Professor Fitzpatrick mentioned earlier on the Hard Edges report, we've seen consistently the missed opportunities. So the problem with the current system is we miss too many opportunities to help people keep the home they have. The question then arises, how do you design a better system? How do you make sure that we're not creating perverse incentives to make homeless applications as the only route to housing? The concern, however, is we're not sitting here designing utopia from a blank piece of paper. We start from a position of a homelessness system in Scotland just now that is broken, fundamentally broken in a way that has never been before, certainly not in the period of devolution. How do we make this transition at a time when the system is not just buckling but has buckled, and the regulator is effectively saying that for the majority of people in Scotland now live in an area where the homelessness system cannot meet its statutory responsibilities? And that's not our opinion, that is the Scottish Housing Regulator's engagement plans that pull that out. So there are, in of itself, that shows that the system isn't working. We need to improve it. The 6 months is a good thing, but is it likely that people will be able to access that when those very same local housing officers have got a backlog of cases that have very little prospect of clearing that backlog of demand?
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Yeah.
Yeah, we absolutely support the 2 months changing to 6 months in terms of domestic abuse. It's not that linear pathway, I mean, in terms of homelessness, but it's well known where women and children may return to perpetrator. So we need as much of a system that allows for that sort of unhealthy route taking place. So the 2 months really doesn't allow for that in itself. What I would add to that is, in these cases, women often want, understandably, legal advice before doing so as well, and that's an absolute it's a pipe dream at the moment. We had a woman make 52 calls recently and yet still not have any legal advice at the end of it. So I think, again, as Gordon's saying to you, as part of such a bigger picture, that there's many different aspects to this to make that achievable. But 2 months to 6 months, absolutely welcomed.
Okay, thank you.
I believe Maggie would like to come in. Thanks.
Thank you. Yes, and just to reiterate the point that we also welcome the extension from 2 to 6 months, and the issue with the current system, of course, is that the overlapping nature of disadvantage, it can't be adequately be met by sectors and services that operate in different silos. And that's not just a fault line within homelessness services, that's a fault line across all of health and social care and other parts of other systems that people navigate as well. And so the minimum that the extension of the 2 to 6 months can do is give more time for that complexity within how services are provided and supports for people can be navigated by people and how they can match more closely in with the range of support that might help prevent their homelessness happening in the first place. And I would just say on the threatened with homelessness point that it would be better within the homelessness bill if there was a clearer definition of what's meant by it. And I think that would help in the implementation stage.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Katie Clarkin. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm going to ask about the domestic abuse provisions, and the policy aim of these provisions is to help protect the rights of women and children experiencing domestic abuse and financial control living in social housing to remain in their home or to be rehoused if that's their wish, and to ensure arrears accrued because of domestic abuse are not a barrier to accessing social housing in the future. The previous panel was of the view that these provisions are achieved in this legislation, so it would be interesting to know whether this panel is also of this view, but also specifically to Jules from Scottish Women's Aid, whether there are issues that you'd like to see included either in the bill or indeed in guidance about social landlord policies that would strengthen this. I think you've stated that there's no mention of young women, so perhaps could you maybe explain, you know, findings in relation to young women and domestic abuse, and whether you feel that the bill or indeed guidance or regulations need to address this in more detail. So I'll go to Jules first, if that's okay.
Thank you. I think, first of all, almost to take a step back and say we're really disappointed that the bill has no gendered lines upon it whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Really disappointed. It was said throughout years, yes, this will be the case. It's nowhere to be seen, no evidence there. So that really needs to be addressed, and that would be a much better starting point. There's lots within the domestic abuse section that we welcome. I guess we have concerns that it becomes a paper exercise in terms of the policy element. So we really want to see those not stopping at that point and actually having requirements in terms of actually implementation and maintenance. You know, it goes back to where I was saying with the Ask and Act as well. You know, it's not just a let's get it right to start with box ticked. We need to ensure that actually it doesn't just stop at the policy, but we're really looking at the practical elements, mm-hmm. and that there's means to actually help registered social landlords get this right as well. You know, it's not a tough call overall, but it's something to embark upon and really ensure that it's done so well. We did a policies not promises report where we looked at the 173 RSLs across the country. Across the country, and we looked to see in terms of who had the right information in terms of their website, a policy, and what engagement there had been with the local community and the domestic abuse experts there. Upon looking at that, there were 9 that actually had something of any merit really in place. And actually, when you unpicked that further, that became 7. So we're not at the best starting point. And that really demonstrates to us that was for the kind of paper element of it. So, yeah, that we need to push much further than that in terms of getting the practice right and the understanding. And not also have, like, a landlord be saying, oh, I need a police incident number, and focusing on those kind of elements instead, thinking, actually, I need to understand how secure a place needs to be. I need to understand the risk. I need to understand and feel confident with all of that as well.
Okay, that's helpful. I don't know if any of the other witnesses would like to come in.
Just very briefly, I think we made the observation that Scottish Government policy just now is to equalise as far as we can renters' rights in both the social and the private sector. And just note that this provision of a pre-action requirement isn't being applied to private renters, so we would welcome seeing how that could be incorporated into the legislation.
That's helpful.
May I just come back briefly on this?
Yeah, briefly, very briefly. Thank you.
Also, one of the key things just now is if we had full commencement of the Domestic Abuse Protection Act Scotland, yes, that would enable us to have the opportunity to have perpetrators move from the property, mm-hmm. and the support to do so, which is such a burden at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCollin. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. And you've actually just touched on this question, so I'm really pleased. Maybe not much more to add, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Mr. McCrae, in your evidence suggests that pre-action requirements for rent arrears cases should apply to private as well. Can you expand a little bit more on your previous comment?
I mean, very basically, domestic violence is as, and, you know, Jules will know better than me, but is as prevalent in all forms of tenure. It's not distinct to the social sector. So if we are seeking these outcomes for people rather than just simply targeting the social sector, and I think there's a hint of undue bias in the assumption that the social sector is where all the problems arise. Of course, we want to see those protections come in, but we would like to see that equalised across the PRS, and they have the ability to do that because there are already pre-action requirements there. So it's not as if you're introducing a new set of approaches prior to seeking possession of the property.
No, that's fine. Answered. Thank you.
Okay, that's lovely. Moving on to theme five, and it's equalities issues and impact on rural areas. I'm going to invite Marie McNair in, who's joining us remotely. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm going to direct this question to Scottish Women's Aid, obviously to Jules. Your evidence questions whether the analyses or consideration as to how homeless prevention duty will apply across equality groups is. Can you expand on your comments and say why this is important and how it can be done in practice? You might have covered it a little bit, but if you could expand, that'd be great. Cheers.
Well, actually, John Mills mentioned this in the previous session, which I was delighted at, but an equalities impact assessment approach is really important to start off with. It's mentioned in Housing to 2040. We're now 3 years on from that, and we started to mention this probably about 10 years ago. I figure I had brown hair at the time. So at that point, we really expected us to be well underway in that. We're not, so we need to start there. But I think there's also real possibilities in terms of RRTPs, and so that can actually enable local authorities to work with and understand communities, because I don't think this is as straightforward as having a kind of blanket one size fits all. So I think the RRTPs provide quite a nice solution there, but stemming from the EQIA as a starting point. Overall, the housing bill, though, yeah, as I've said, the gendered lens, but actually also in terms of intersectionality, nowhere to be seen. You know, we've got Pride starting next weekend, and yet cultural diversity is not there within this housing bill, which is really, really pretty disappointing.
Yeah, that's something we'll take back. Thank you. Do any other panel members have any views on whether the bill sufficiently accounts for impacts on different equality groups, or is there other action needed to make improvements? Just pop that out there. Obviously, mindful of the time, so if you're quite quick with your comments, that'd be great. Cheers.
I think I can see Maggie want to come in, so I don't want to step on her toes, but the lack of an anti-racist lens, I think, is something that's evident to us. We did some research last year with Heriot Watt University looking at the experiences of minoritised ethnic groups in Scotland when seeking to access homelessness, the homelessness services, and it showed us that the majority of minoritised ethnic people who responded to the survey had experienced racial harassment in their home across all tenures, and that element doesn't come out. You know, the idea that people are victims of harassment and that may have an impact on why they're presenting as homeless, what support they require, what allocation of an alternative home might be in there. It just doesn't exist in the analysis in the bill at present.
Thanks for that, Maggie.
Absolutely, and just to support the points that are made, that we what we know about housing overall is that almost all groups that have characteristics that are protected by equalities legislation are disadvantaged in the housing system in different ways and at different times. So there's a real opportunity here within the housing bill to really prioritise an equalities impact assessment and to make that something that's much more textured than a set of boxes that are ticked in a few lines of contextual kind of narrative. narrative that we really need to up our game round about this and make sure that we can take an equalities competent lens to prevention duties and to the housing bill overall. We made an approach, I think maybe a couple of years of the set up of the Housing to 2040 group, for a specialist kind of subgroup or advisory group that would work alongside the Housing to 2040 group to ensure that that range of expertise across the different characteristics could be brought together and could steer the work. So I think it's still really interesting to make that point here today and to get that on the record. We need people with specialism to steer the rest of us on this.
Well, Maggie, I actually agree with your comments, absolutely. Convener, swiftly back to yourself.
Okay, I just wanted to add one comment, and I have actually done quite a bit of work with Professor Stephen Maxwell on intimate partner violence, and that touches upon, you know, homelessness as well and the impact that and just on the topic that we're talking about. And yeah, we had a round table in here as well. It was really interesting, the evidence that we took from it. So yeah, I was conscious of that in terms of when looking at the bill as well. So thank you. Now I'm going to invite Paul O'Keenan, who is joining us remotely. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I think just to follow on from Marie McNair in terms of these issues, and this particular question is directed to Gordon, just because in Shelter Scotland's evidence, they have said that, you know, consideration could also be given to, I suppose, anti-racism responsibilities within the bill. So it would be good maybe just to get a wee bit more context of what you think that might look like and indeed the need for it.
Sure. As mentioned, obviously, the starting point is the people who will be the kind of contact point, the people doing the asking and the acting, have been supported to understand the what anti-racism means as distinct from identifying discrimination, but actually what the systemic drivers behind, you know, why are certain communities consolidated in, you know, certain groups consolidated in certain localities, and what are those drivers? How does that impact on some of their available choices? There is just a need to, as Maggie says, up our game, and I think it's a fair reflection that, you know, we've not been at the forefront of this in Scotland in terms of embedding an anti-racist understanding of what barriers people face when trying to engage with services, the difference between an equitable approach versus the idea of everyone's equal at the point of access doesn't always understand that some people in some communities have different needs and require different provisions. So in terms of what the legislation should do, I think we would be keen to see explicit reference to the fact that equalities issues, and especially anti-racism, are a driver for homelessness. People who have experienced racial harassment are more likely to present within the homelessness system, but we just don't see that lens. And I think it's similar to the gendered analysis that was never done of the Ending Homelessness Together strategy. You know, we just need to sort of build these things in at this stage in policy deliberations, rather than after the fact when we try to come back to the implementation process.
Thank you very much. I mean, that's very helpful, and I certainly think it's something we'll want to reflect on across all of these equality strands, so very useful. I wonder if I can just turn to the rural kind of aspect of this. We've been having a number of discussions this morning about differences between homelessness and the solutions that are required in our rural communities in Scotland. So I suppose this is quite a big question, but it would be good to get a sense from the panel of how far the provisions go to seek to address, you know, specific issues within rural communities. I don't know who wants to kick off, sorry.
I mean, to be honest, I think I've already touched on mine in terms of the possibilities that lend themselves from the local authorities working closely much better with, and I don't get me wrong, some do really work very well with their local women's aid and domestic abuse groups and experts, but I think there's definitely room for improvement and for that to be an actual kind of national must, I guess.
I don't know if Maggie would like to come in.
Yeah, I mean, a general point, I think reflecting on the question, actually, the bill and the prevention provisions probably don't go far enough to consider the unique kind of circumstances and geographies of rural areas. And it would be probably incumbent, I think, on all of us to have a look at that again and make sure that it can go a bit further. I think there's... absolutely. I think I'll probably leave that point there. Thank you.
Thanks. And I wonder if I can just follow up very briefly, Maggie. The cross-party group on poverty in the Scottish Parliament have done a piece of work on rural poverty and those premiums that exist. And is that something you would recognise within the housing space as well, that there comes a premium almost to your homeless experience because you are rural?
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah, there's additional risk and additional cost and other factors as a result of being in the circumstance.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Now, the last theme, which is the implementation and any other issues, and I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
I think if I could start with you, Gordon, because you picked this up already, in regard to, you know, how do we make sure these are actually embedded and what authority do we have? I wonder if you could just maybe unpack that a bit more. I mean, would you want to see some form of ability to do judicial review of if they are failing, or how would you want that to be more legally enforceable?
So I would start by just reflecting what our model of service provision is. So at Shelter Scotland, we are predominantly an advice and legal representation organisation. We do some other services, but we don't do the types of intensive support that some of other colleagues in the sector do. So we start from the basis of we quite often work with those colleagues to pick up cases where people's rights have been breached, and we use our legal representation to be able to challenge that. And that can reach the level of judicial review, but more often than not, it's a case-by-case challenge that we take. And so we are embedded in this idea of individuals have rights. We have a rights-based homelessness system. And for those rights to be manifested, an individual has to be able to seek redress if the duty bearer fails to deliver on to uphold their duties. And it's a concern for us when we describe the prevention provisions in this bill as duties, that it's just not clear to us whether that will be fleshed out in the secondary legislation or not. How does an individual seek redress if their homelessness is not prevented by the public body who have that duty? Now, I appreciate that's a slightly semantic issue on one level, but it very much reflects our kind of way of thinking. So how do we support an individual? It's just not clear. I think we would observe the bill as a whole has massive gaps in it in terms of the detail. It's very much an enabling bill for the legislation that is really the meat is yet to come. It's in the secondary legislation. But for us, therefore, the test of can this be a success has to be, are we clear about accountability lines? Are we clear about the right to provision? You know, the right to review for local authorities is welcome, but the vision here is far greater. So how do we make sure that the individuals, and this is about individuals, this isn't about how we get producers to produce a little bit better. Yeah. It's about people experiencing homelessness or at risk of experiencing homelessness. Will this make an impact on their lives? And right now we can't make a judgment on that because we haven't got the detail.
So I can push you a wee bit, what meat, to use your words, would you want there so we can be guided as a committee on that?
Well, certainly the opportunity to take to a judicial review, I think clarity around what the responsibilities actually are, what does it look like to take that action, how would we recognise that it's not happening by a public body? Right now, when we look at the homelessness duties, local authorities have to report whenever they're breaching whether it's the unsuitable accommodation order or the failure to accommodate. How will the public bodies, because it won't just be local authorities, how will they self-report and identify and provide a data trail for how they are upholding these, and what interventions will either individuals or a regulator make? You know, will the regulator have the ability to say to an education authority that they have to review their policies and procedures because they have been found to consistently fail to uphold the Ask and Act duty? That would be the sorts of detail we would be expecting to be able to say that this has the teeth that it needs to make a difference to people's lives.
I don't know if either of the two other panellists want to come in on this.
simply agreeing with everything Gordon said. I don't think he's been he's covered it all. We have nothing more really to add.
I think Maggie would like to come in, if you could come in briefly, Maggie. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the majority of responses to the bill have been in favour of the prevention duties, and of the noted concerns, most of those are in delivery. And that kind of mirrors our position too, that the legal framework is broadly correct. There's a lot to get right in delivery. Collaboration will be key, and the financial memorandum just doesn't go far enough. Some of the caveats to our support are the need for a definition of threatened with homelessness, more to underpin the reasonable steps. Absolutely agreeing with Gordon's point about redress for people, including judicial review. It is a gap and it does need to go in. We would like to see more round about the personal housing plan. And actually not mentioned today, we would like to see supported housing introduced and reclassified as a settled housing outcome in terms of current homelessness duties and new prevention duties as well. And that aligns with another piece of work that's going on in the sector at the moment.
Okay, thank you. So thank you all for joining us today and for all your contributions as well. So next week we'll hear from two more panels on the bill. Witnesses will include stakeholder organisations as well as relevant bodies subject to the bill's Ask and Act duty to prevent homelessness. So this concludes our public business for today. We'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you.